Cities have been existing all around the world for thousands of years. From the cities that surrounded the Great Pyramids of Giza, to ancient Rome, to all the wonderful cities that cropped up in Europe all along from 1000 AD all the way to our modern day. However, what made these cities grow exponentially was trains. We hear the train rumbling right underneath. Trains that were innovated in the mid-1800s made cities like New York, made cities like London grow bigger and bigger, and Paris as well. Today we're going to learn about the secrets of Penn Station and learn about the new Moynihan Train Hall. So let's go and explore New York City's Penn Station, learn about what used to stand here before Penn Station, and let's go into Moynihan Train Hall for the first time, including my very first time. So this is going to be my very first time inside here. I actually never been into the new Moynihan Train Hall, which just opened up in New Year's Day yesterday. So I'm excited to walk in and actually give you my first impressions as I walk in. I've been to Penn Station many times. It's one of the stations I use the most here in New York City. So you're going to see my firsthand reaction, and let's see what the history is about, because why do we have a train station in the post office? Well, let's find out. Welcome everyone, nice to see you here. I'm Ariel, you're watching Urbanist. And here we are at the corner of 31st Street and 8th Avenue. This is Madison Square Garden, the structure that ended up replacing the original old Penn Station. So before we actually walk in, let me actually show you how this post office used to look like back in 1912. So here's the photo of the post office back in 1912. Now this is the Fairleigh Post Office. Was built in honor and in order to complement what used to be old Penn Station. We have to go back to the 1800s. Locomotion ends up becoming a gigantic deal. It ends up expanding U.S. power beyond these few cities on the eastern coast like New York, Boston, and Philadelphia, as expanding westward. Ends up connecting New York City, the east, with cities like San Francisco in the west. This was the key to the expansion of the U.S. growing economically and industrially. However, one of the bigger companies, the Pennsylvania Railroad, was a bit stuck because they couldn't expand and get to New York City. All the trains terminated at modern day Hoboken and other parts like modern day New Jersey City. It was very inconvenient. Something had to be done because there was another company that actually got their way right in the middle of the city. The New York Central Railroad, the company owned by the Vanderbilts. They already had Grand Central Depot. So the Pennsylvania Railroad Company and the Western Railroad Company had to do something. So the man who wanted to do something was actually born into massive amounts of wealth. His name was Alexander Cassatt. Now, Alexander Cassatt became the president of the Western Railroad Company right here. And this is the extent of the railroad system back then. Now let's cross the street. Thank you so much for a $5 super chat, Edward. I appreciate you, Edward. Thank you. Now his vision was to build a monumental train station that would put every other train station to shame. So he ended up building right here an homage to the baths of Caracalla, which used to look like this back in ancient Rome, to the massive amount St. Peter's Basilica, which has a gigantic nave, and actually visited it if you want to see the entire way through on Urbanist Bonus subsequent channel, or on Facebook I have it as well. This was the Grand Old Penn Station. We'll learn a little bit more about Grand Old Penn Station, but then in the late 50s, early 60s, it was destroyed and replaced with this monstrosity, Madison Square Garden. So, Edward, thank you so much for $5 super chat. Let's walk into Moynihan Train Hall. Since Old Penn Station was destroyed, everything was forced to be underground. It was kind of stuffed underground. One architectural critic said, "Once we entered the city like gods, now we scuttle in like rats," saying that used to be grand monumental architecture and now you're kind of going to this cramped underground station. That was Penn Station, one of the most hated stations in all of New York City for decades. So much so that even in the show Broad City, there's one funny scene where Elena is dating a new guy, and they think that they have to catch a train at Grand Central, and they go to Grand Central in a rush to go to some wedding, but then they end up realizing, oh, it's actually, they had to go to Penn Station to go upstate for the wedding. And she tells the date, oh, we had to actually go to Penn Station. And they says, "Elena, I'm sorry, but I can't do Penn Station. It's one of the worst places on earth. I have to break up with you." And he breaks up with her because he can't go to Penn Station. So a very funny scene. So I'm excited to see how they're revitalizing it. Let's go inside. Hey, Jay. Hello, Mags. Mags, welcome, Mags, as a new moderator. Moynihan Train Hall. Let's go inside. Oh, my God. Lisa, thank you for letting me know. Here's the construction of Moynihan Train Hall. Before we go inside, this is actually a really cool video. So it was carved into the post office. Now the majority of the post office is actually owned by Facebook. And I think the post office still has a little bit left. And also now it's also the train hall. So it's a gigantic complex now, becoming very similar to King's Road complex, King's Cross complex in London. So there you can see they're building the skylight, all inside this historic building from 1912. Amazing. Bruce, thank you for clarifying. Leasing, yes, leasing. Facebook is leasing the space. So I love how clean it is, and I love that there's no staircases. This is awesome. It's all a ramp. And here we are. Karen, Facebook is leasing the other part of this building. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen. Melissa, thank you so much for the stars. Oh, look at that. Wow. Oh, they did a really good job here. Both classical and modern at the same time. A little bit Beaux-Arts, a little bit Art Deco with the clock especially. Oh, I love this. Wood finishes? Ooh, this is amazing. Oh, I'm really impressed. Hey, Dawal. Do clarify, let me know how you say your name, because Dawal might be pronounced differently. Jose says a $5 coffee donation. Oh, thank you so much, Jose. I appreciate you.
Attention.
Wow.
This is the last call for K-Track and Park Service Team 2883
on Grand Tonight and Falls to Passengers should receive track 6. Joe said, watch the Wi-Fi here. People had issues. Live streaming, I can imagine, yeah. Look how gorgeous this is. So this clock, I love it. To me, it looks Art Deco style. I would say most likely it is intentionally done Art Deco style. And Art Deco, of course, was a huge, they used a lot of steel beams. So I love the kind of homage to old New York here. Now why is it called Moynihan? Sounds like a strange name. You would think superficially, if you don't know too much about New York, you would think that that is a Native American name, a Lenape Native American name. Not quite. It's actually an Irish name. It's named after Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who was a U.S. Senator on behalf of New York for 4 terms, which is 16 years. Moynihan, yeah, Pat Moynihan. Really inspirational guy as I was looking into him. Classic New Yorker, raised in Hell's Kitchen and other parts of New York. This is him right here. He was one of the first people to really take very seriously on a national level on how to improve the well-being of Americans, especially the ones who were stuck in poverty. He helped Lyndon B. Johnson formulate the so-called War on Poverty. He was also an advisor to many other presidents and then later became senator. Look into Moynihan. I don't discuss politics here. The interesting thing about Moynihan, but I'll tell you this. The interesting thing about Moynihan is that he was talking about things back in the 1950s and 60s and 70s that are affecting us right now. He was talking about this many decades ago, and some things also about New York City specifically. So the reason it's named after Moynihan, I recommend looking into him if you are into politics, not to discuss here, but on your own, because he's really inspirational in my opinion. But the reason they call him the station after him is because he wanted to revitalize Penn Station all the way back in the 1990s. So we're taking our sweet, sweet time, ladies and gentlemen. Of course, we gotta have massive ads. And I think this might be a travel ad, maybe, or no. Is this an ad or it's not? Wait, ladies and gentlemen, this is not an ad. Oh my God, there's a gigantic screen, and this is not an ad. Wow, this is a miracle, ladies and gentlemen, a miracle, a true Christmas miracle. We have a gigantic screen, and it's not advertisement. Wow. I love this. All right, let's check out the seating. So in order to sit down, you have to be an Amtrak ticket. And look at the wooden seating. We'll show it from afar. Beautiful. They have outlets right there in USB. Surprised they're not making a USB-C. I think they had to future-proof it a little bit. So this is this new seating area. I wish I could do a bench review here, but maybe I'll do another bench, which is accessible. This one, I need to have an Amtrak ticket. Padded too, yeah. It's padded in a way where it's not padded with cloth on the exterior, so you won't get bed bugs, which is good. Elisa says, do a bathroom test. No, Elisa, not quite that type of channel. That would maybe be more of a something for a blog rather than a video. So what does this Moynihan Station service? This service is mostly the Amtrak, but of course it's connected to Penn Station. So the entire complex will soon maybe be renamed to Empire Station, which Andrew Cuomo, our mayor, our governor, is championing to make a whole new Penn Station that would be Empire Station. This is him right here. So who does this service? Well, it services three different train systems. The New Jersey Transit, Amtrak, which right now mostly Moynihan is for the Amtrak, and the Long Island Railroad, which you can also access from here. Those are the three main transits that are serviced here. So three gigantic services. Now, Long Island Railroad is huge because the entire island of Long Island has a population of more than 7 million people. And there's a man taking a 360 video. That's so cool. Maybe I should do a 360 video soon. Let me know if you want a 360 video here. Is Moynihan still alive? No. So Donald says, I like the inclusion of E pluriverus unum. Yeah, me too. Out of many, one. I wonder if he's a YouTuber doing a live stream. On 360, it's a bit hard to do live streams with the new 360 cameras, so most likely not. But let me know if you want to see a 360 recorded video here. That's an impressive clock. I agree. Let's zoom in on that clock. Kind of has an Oculus vibe. Yeah, great, nice and fly. Yeah, great observation. Has a bit of a vibe to the Oculus. We'll have access to Long Island Railroad. Yes, you can enter here and go underneath one of the, right over here. We'll find it later. We'll see how to get to Penn Station underground. You could get above ground, but if you're going to a station, might as well stick underground. So we're going to see how to get underground somewhere around here. Stay tuned. Has the Art Deco feel. Yeah, precisely. That's what I see as well. So the Amtrak is a massive system that services the majority of the U.S. for passenger rail and also freight rail. Freight rail is kind of at its last legs. I don't think you'll be seeing freight rail last for any more than 10 years, definitely because of the replacement of autonomous trucks are coming on. But passenger rail is still very popular. It's getting actually rising popularity. I myself took Amtrak to Boston and to Washington, D.C., and actually enjoyed it. It was nice. But as I mentioned, the Long Island Railroad is the one that has the majority of the traffic. It services 7 million people. A good chunk of them are indeed using the Long Island Railroad. And this is the entire railroad system from Penn Station all through Queens, Brooklyn, and into all the way to the very other side, Montauk. We'll see what destinations are these trains. Let's see if any train is boarding at this moment, and we'll go downstairs. Can you take an Amtrak to Toronto? I don't think so. I think Amtrak is only within the US. I wish we had high-speed rail to Canada. It would be so awesome to take a high-speed rail to Montreal or Toronto. I'm not 100% sure. Let me know. I don't think it's possible. But it would be so great. It would be so great if there was also high-speed rail to Mexico. I would love to go to Mexico City via train. But let's see, what are the new departures? Here's the Amtrak ticketing and baggage check-in. Let's see. Where can we go at this very moment in time? There is a Amtrak via rail connection to Toronto. Oh, thank you for letting us know. So you can take it to Toronto. Oh, that's awesome. Okay, thank you everyone for letting me know. But Mexico, I think, is still a no. Are there other options? Can you go to other places? So here, you're going to Washington, Boston, Albany, Norfolk, Springfield. Who is this? Kevin says, freight rail, only 10 years left. I think you're misinformed. Do your own research. It's quite a complicated topic to talk about, but basically, it's much more economical moving forward to have autonomous trucks. And since autonomous trucks are going to be so economically efficient and also efficient on the industrial level, because they're a lot more maneuverable, they can go to more specific places, they're driving by themselves, so you don't have to pay massive labor costs, you don't have to maintain massive tracks, you have to maintain the roads, and I'm not entirely sure about the logistics, but I have a intuition that roads are actually easier to maintain than tracks. All that consideration, there's gonna be a big monumental shift that's coming soon towards autonomous trucks that will most certainly replace the freight rail industry. Might not seem that way at this very moment in time, but especially if you look into it, how the economics pan out, there's going to be a monumental shift in my perspective from what I've researched. Hey, who is this? Tom, thank you so much for showing us around. Does this also service New Jersey Transit? Yes, it'll still all be Penn Station. So I think they'll increase the connectivity between these two halls at some point. But let's actually go Penn Station. Let's see. Thank you so much, Tom, for a 99 super chat. I appreciate you. Those kids are having fun. Indeed they are. Can you go to the second floor down? Yeah, I'll go to the second floor down soon. But let's see. Elisa, yeah, I'll be showing you as much as possible the train. Oh, Magnolia is going up here. Is the U.S. Army guarding? No, they would be National Guard, I think. Not the Army, but the National Guard is indeed part of the military. Welcome. Big Dog and Shields. Krispy Kreme donut is below. Ooh, cool. All right, let's explore. Yeah, Army and National Guard dress the same. So, yeah, you'll be seeing them almost dressed the same. All right, so here we have the Amtrak. And here we have Long Island Railroad. Only 21 tracks here as well. So it's actually a very small amount of tracks compared to the 60 plus that Grand Central Terminal has. So what's back here? Let's see. Let's go upstairs before we go downstairs. Ooh, restrooms. Look at that. Restrooms down there. Echo test? Ooh. I would assume the echo is not so good. Oh, there is a little bit of echo. Not too much. A little bit of echo. Well, I'd be getting coffee, maybe. Jose did sponsor coffee, so, and Edward as well, so maybe, stay tuned. Show us the art on the entrance. All right, let's see, is there art on the entrance? Yeah, there is. You have to look up. You gotta look up, always look up. There's another one. That's so cool. It's a skyline and upside down. Blue Bottle is opening up a branch here in the train hall. Oh, that's great news. We definitely need a alternative to Starbucks. Clifford says, do I know if the ventilation system was upgraded for COVID? Ooh, I'm not entirely sure. I would assume so. The Long Island Railroad is definitely taking that seriously. I'm not 100% sure. Darren, thank you so much for letting us know the about the military. So Darren says, the Posse Comitatus Act says that the military can't operate within U.S. borders, but the National Guard can operate within the U.S. as their civilian soldiers. Thank you. Prepi, me gustan tus videos. Gracias. All right, let's go upstairs. That's breathtaking. I agree. Yeah, it is quite breathtaking. I see it from a different angle. There's elevators, of course, so it's going to be accessible. And here they help out with accessibility. So if you are mobily impaired at the moment, you can access elevators and there are people who will be able to help you in case you need any further help, assistance. How many levels? Let's see. Seems there are three. This upper floor, the ground floor, and the lower track level. Facial coverings while in stations and aboard trains. To learn more about what we are doing to ensure a safe environment, please visit Amtrak.com. For instructions on how to create your own facial covering, please visit CDC.gov. Thank you for choosing. Is the post office no longer operational? It is. So the area we're in right now used to be the sorting facility for the post office. The post office still, I think, has a small part of the building. Facebook has leased the majority part of the building. Jackie says, I'm mobility impaired, so that's excellent. Yes, there's ramps. This is a lot more friendlier than the old Penn Station, which I'll show you old Penn Station soon. Not the old Penn Station, the one that is currently still existing. Was the woman on loudspeaker stating something along the lines of wear a mask and they have instructions how to make your own mask if you don't have one. That's what she said. This is so beautiful. Wow. Thank you. Does this replace old pen? So pen is not... No. This on 34th Street. 42nd Street, the stations there are Port Authority on 42nd Street is Grand Central Terminal. So they're all different stations. Kay says, almost look like it's pre-recorded. Oh no, you're definitely watching it live. Hey, do you know if they added air filtration system? That I don't know for sure. Great question. If anyone can find that information, I would hope so, to be honest. This does not get covered in bird poo, and they have taken. Let me know. What are your bets? Will this be covered in bird poo at some point? All right, let's go back downstairs. It seems like there is bad service. Did old Penn Station look like this building? I'll show it to you soon. Stay tuned. Mr. T says, we need a reality check. Show us Port Authority. I think that would not be a reality check. I think that would be rather depressing to see that difference. So I hope the service is good now. Did the old Penn Station look like this? There is homage to the old Penn Station, especially with the huge steel beams. So let me show you a little bit of old Penn Station and let me know if the video quality is good now. So as Penn Station was coming to its later days, the old Penn Station, they had a huge skylight, a skylight way bigger than the skylight you would see in Grand Central Terminal. So it was a lot more filled with light like we are right now. But towards its later days, before it was demolished in the 60s, it was covered in bird poo and tar from all the millions of people smoking every single year. So luckily there's no more indoor smoking in here, but birds are still out and about. I'm not sure how they will combat that. Let me know if anyone knows those details. Now I'm very curious about that. So this is indeed an homage to old Penn Station. And right here is what old Penn Station looked like. Built by Charles McKim, who was a part of the famous trio of architects, McKim, Mead, and White. A lot of people already know Stanford White for Washington Square Park. And the old Madison Square Garden, if you're into New York City history, you probably heard about that. He is known for a lot of famous buildings all around New York. But right in the middle is Charles McKim. And he's also known for many popular buildings in the U.S. These guys were the superstar architects of the United States during the Gilded Age. Charles McKim also was responsible for the Morgan Library. Now, as I mentioned, this used to be a gigantic, massive nave on the bigger scale than the St. Peter's Basilica or the Baths of Caracalla. And this is how it looked like back then. And here is how it looked like above. So I mentioned the skylights. It was enormous, yeah. And then 1960s roll around, and Penn Station is declared a blight upon the city. Great question. Why did they destroy the building? Asked Alex. Well, Penn Station was running out of money. Pennsylvania Railroad Company was running out of money. It was because peak years for old Penn Station was 42 and 44, right in World War II. A lot of people, millions of people, were using the railroad to get around the U.S. That was the main mode of transportation. But what happened right after World War II? World War II, Truman and Eisenhower had a massive project to build an interstate highway system, crisscrossing highways through the entire United States of America. Those highways were to service vehicles. They're also made in part to protect the U.S. also militarily. At least, actually, that was the main reason, but not publicly. The public reason was like, so people could drive around the U.S. and trucks can drive around the U.S. This interstate highway system paved the way, literally paved the way for suburbanization and for the use of the vehicle, the car. A lot of more people were being car owners. But there was also another innovation post-World War II. That was the jet airplane. And the jet airplane also paved the way for commercial jet airliners that were taking passengers from New York to London, New York to Paris, New York to San Francisco, to Los Angeles, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So now any type of train ride that was, say, 3 hours or less kind of became useless from the eyes of the common American. They started just using airplanes, or they would go on a road trip and use a car. Thus, the railroads by the late 1950s, early 1960s, were bleeding money. Freight rail was still in use, but it wasn't quite enough to sustain these massive railroad networks. So they owned this gigantic building, or the one that used to stand right where modern day Madison Square Garden now stands. And they thought to themselves, how can we maximize our profits? There was two choices. Was to revitalize the station and kind of build an office building within the station. However, that wasn't as profitable as destroying the entire station and leasing it or giving or selling it to new development for the Madison Square Garden and for office buildings. Well, they actually destroyed that Penn Station, and concurrently, as they were destroying Penn Station, they were building Madison Square Garden. So the railroad could stay afloat, but even then, the railroad couldn't stay afloat, even with the destruction of Penn Station and all that money coming in from Madison Square Garden. Same thing with Grand Central a few years later. They were setting themselves up for demolition. They wanted to destroy the entire building and have I.M. Pei build this gigantic skyscraper. But I.M. Pei's design would have completely changed that landscape of that area of Manhattan. So they decided, in order to appease the people who were already distraught by the destruction of Penn Station and made up the Landmarks Commission, which was signed into law by Mayor Wagner, Grand Central decided to make a new plan where they were going to build a gigantic skyscraper on top of Grand Central. But also those plans were scrapped, because if we were to build a gigantic skyscraper on top of Grand Central, they said that the main Grand Central level would just become a curiosity rather than still a landmark. The thing is, even with the landmarks preservation and the ability then later to sell air rights to nearby buildings, because these buildings own air rights, since they are limited by height because of landmarks laws, they can sell their air rights to nearby buildings so they can build higher, or another neighborhood so they can build higher. New York Central Railroad, who owns Grand Central, was also not able to make their money back, and they also went defunct. That's why in the 1970s, the US government created Amtrak, which was a way to preserve passenger rail. That's why these companies, and that's why rail travel wasn't really prioritized in the US as much as in Europe. Here we saw the car and the plane as better ways of transportation. And Jackie Kennedy. So Jackie Kennedy was involved in preserving Grand Central as well. It's because of her name. She was a very big name at that time, especially after the death of President Kennedy. She was a big name, so having her name plastered in the saving Grand Central helped save Grand Central. But Penn Station, unfortunately, did not. Penn Station, to many New Yorkers, they thought it was a blight. The ceilings were filled with bird poo. So much smoke, things were all cloudy and dark in the middle of old Penn Station. To many people, it seemed like a blight upon the city. But the moment was being destroyed as they saw these huge steel beams being crumbled down these gigantic hallways that started to look like the ruins of ancient Rome. They realized what they end up losing. That's why we have a landmarks laws all around the US at this point, and landmarks laws in many major cities around the world. All right. All right, now let's, right over here, let's see what's over here. Here's the Amtrak kind of a members lounge. So Clifford says, of those laws were because of what happened to Penn Station. You can make that relationship, yes. I wonder what they're going to do with the old Amtrak area. That's what I'm wondering as well. So let's check out the current Penn Station. Let's go. No ads yet. Just the beautiful images of New York City and other places. Oh, yeah, New York City. So beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Let's go now. So Miguel asks another great question. Is this inspired by the Crystal Palace of London, or the Crystal Palace that used to be in Bryant Park? The only Crystal Palace still standing is the one in Madrid. So if you want to see photos of that. Yes, in a way, yes. Because the Crystal Palace was the very first cast iron building that had these huge steel beams. And they were able to make the building mostly out of windows and glass. And that major innovation is what paved the way for stations like Paddington in London, the station in Paris, which is now the Museum d'Orsay, and paved the way for Old Penn Station and also Grand Central. It was because of the Crystal Palace in London that later inspired the Crystal Palace in Bryant Park and the Crystal Palace in Madrid. It was because of that. May, I'm so glad you enjoyed the historical ceiling. Of course, Starbucks, there's always has to be a Starbucks, is required by law. I'm joking around. It's required by law to basically have a Starbucks everywhere. In any major train station or airport in the U.S. Clean floors give you peace. Oh, I'm so glad, Luciano. All right. So you guys enjoyed the new Moynihan station. Now let's see the current Penn Station and kind of give you give you an insight of what many New Yorkers had to go through in these past few decades. So now we're going underneath between 34th Street and 31st Street into the area below Madison Square Garden. Let's go. So say goodbye to the beautiful station. I'll be doing a 360 video and a silent walkthrough soon. Stay tuned. Alex says, thanks for the education. Always interesting. Love your content. My pleasure, Alex. Thank you so much for the €5 super chat. All right, everyone. Say goodbye to the beautiful station. We are entering what is known as one of the worst places in all of New York. The station that is the bane of the existence of commuters that pass through here, scuttling in like rats every single day. Let's go into the current Penn Station. Here is the Long Island Railroad. Actually, let's go into the tracks. This track has bad service, I think. Let's go into 20. Hey, walking commuter, nice to see you here. Hope you're doing well. All right, hopefully this has good service. Let me know. I'll show you the tracks and along on the railroad. This railroad is located underneath Hudson Yards. So this is a Long Island Railroad train and it's going to the train yards. It is a comfortable train, yeah, Luciano, it is. I ride the Long Island Railroad. Bad service. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. So you can see how long the train is. Let's go up. Oh, right here. Look at the bedrock. So trains are built within the bedrock. Look at that. Look at that. Where are the double-decker trains? Double-decker trains are Long Island Railroad, and usually they go out to Montauk. And I think one other line. I think they're in two lines. But Montauk is one of the lines. Are these tracks new? No. These tracks date from back to old Penn Station. Is the bedrock the same as Central Park? Yes. It's a Manhattan schist. The bedrock doesn't give any schists to construction. The Long Island Railroad is way more than $275, yes. The lowest price I think you could pay for a railroad right now is like $5 to get to Jamaica, Queens, or Woodside. Otherwise, it's between $8 to $40 around there, $30. All right, here we are at the current Penn Station, ladies and gentlemen. Look how nice. Oh, I feel so at peace here. So beautiful. I'm so excited to walk in through to current Penn Station. Ugh. All right, it's for the tour. Let's go into Old Penn Station. But wait, at least among this depressive station, pun intended, there's some secrets, at least. So history will be able to keep us surviving through this very kind of depressing station. So a lot of this has the remnants of old Penn Station. It's a little bit hard to kind of spot the first time you're coming here. Or even for many New Yorkers, they don't even know what they're seeing. So as I mentioned, what is this now used to be this, ladies and gentlemen. Imagine what we have come to. It used to be this. It used to be this. So, and this is how the train tracks used to look like, which we saw before. So one of the few remnants of this train station is these brass handles and the entrances. So before, there would be light streaming in, as I showed you on the photos. And when you would enter your track, you would go to this beautiful staircase, which used to be very beautiful with these brass finishes. And you would go into your train off into Long Island or to the heartland of America. And this is one of the few remnants of old Penn Station here as well. So imagine going up here, and I'll show you, Ravi here. Let's actually zigzag around. You'll be going up here, and you'll be seeing light. You'll be seeing something that looks like the ancient Roman baths. But now you have this. We went from light, natural skylight, filling the souls of the everyday New Yorker to something that drains our energy due to the very boring fluorescent light. So Moynihan is replacing this section, which is Amtrak. Hey, G, Gregory. Gregory asked, did they have to demolish / change part of Grand Central in order to allow the construction of Pan Am? No. As far as I know, no. No nothing was adjusted. So Pan Am was built directly behind Grand Central, but they didn't actually mess with Grand Central Terminal at all. But that wasn't the original plan. The original plan was to build a skyscraper on top of Grand Central as well. Thank you for the $10 super chat.
Attention, please. Now boarding on track 3, both east.
Thank you, Kay. Kay, I'll be reaching out. Thank you so much for volunteering to be a moderator.
Making stops at Secaucus, Newark Broad Street, East Orange, Greek Church, Orange, South Orange.
So here are the bathrooms of Penn Station.
Summit, Chatham, Madison.
Do they have sniffer dogs? Yeah, there's usually sniffer dogs. Moynihan finished. So far, yes, it is finished. Will there be more Penn Station? Yes, they're planning to revitalize this entire station. Am I directly under Madison Square Garden? Yeah, Madison Square Garden is basically right over here. So back in the 1960s, one of the most famous American architects who built wonderful libraries, who was known for making this monumental style of architecture, including the Four Freedoms Park in Roosevelt Island, the very north part of Roosevelt Island. His name was Louis Kahn. Louis Kahn, great architect, became a little bit controversial later in his life when people found out he was actually having two families at the same time. He ended up dying at the Penn Station bathroom from a heart attack. So this is where world famous architect Louis Kahn passed away.
Attention, please.
Not the now best way to pass away. Oh, goddamn. I feel so bad to even, you know that that happened to Louis Kahn. He was so talented. Such a terrible way to go. What is it, the smell? Luckily I have a mask. Let's say that. Luckily, I'm wearing a mask. It smells funky, right? A little bit sterile, sterilized. It just smells like some type of sterilization. Sanitization, you know, a little bit of hand sanitizer smell. That kind of plasticky smell from Starbucks. Yep, smells a little bit like plastic pastries. And old Penn Station used to have statues like these. This one you can find at the Brooklyn Museum. So we went from beautiful statuary to ads. Now, Penn Station is also known as hell on earth for many New Yorkers. This is how crowded it used to get in pre-pandemic times. Now, as I'm walking, I'm going to show you a clip as we go back down to the Long Island Railroad section. Actually, I'll show you the New Jersey Transit section. I'm going to show you a clip of an amazing Hitchcock film called Strangers on the Train. He actually filmed a very pivotal scene in Old Penn Station. So as we're walking around, just watch this clip and just imagine we're back in those times and not here now. Are there pickpockets? Usually no. No, there's not that many people complain about pickpockets here.
Thank you.
So right here, Strangers on the Train. And that is Old Penn Station. And there, here we can see the way you would get to Penn Station via the taxi or before when it was originally built in 1910 by a horse carriage. And here is the construction of Old Penn Station.
By 1880, many thousand miles of track had
been
laid.
As we go through the New Jersey Transit.
The progress of its railroads became one and the same. Was harnessed to the railroad. Hudson River, New York City, and Pennsylvania, serving in the last 10 years alone more than 757 million passengers.
Thank you for letting me know. Yeah.
The all-rail link with New England and the South and West was established.
This is different. Right, right. Right, have a great day, man. Thank you. So he was saying that there is these beautiful murals that show like the views of New Jersey. So it's buffering that service here. I'll give you one pro tip, one positive thing about this area. Actually, it's not positive because it's still closed. Oh no. I hope they reopen. Here, what used to be Zarro's, one of the best black and white cookies in New York City. They have stores in each of the major stations. They're still closed. Ah, that's a shame. Arnell, thank you so much for reminding people to smash that like button. All right, let's go back down to the Long Island Railroad. Now, as we're going downstairs, here's another view of Old Penn Station. This is what used to be known as the waiting room. Ironically, it had no benches, but this was the waiting room. Now, Penn Station was also revolutionary because it was the first major train tunnel in the US. Tunneling was used for much smaller things back in the early 1900s. So it was a huge, massive feat to build a tunnel underneath, which is 1 mile of long of the East River, the width. And this is how the tunnel looked like. So this is the tunnel going from New Jersey all the way down underneath the Hudson River, which is 1 mile wide, to Penn Station, expanding to 21 tracks, which end up being paled in comparison to Grand Central, which end up being more than 60. And then it continues underneath Manhattan towards underneath the East River, heading into Sunnyside Yards. So Sunnyside Yards ends up being the big train yards of the system. And here's a photo of Sunnyside. So Sunnyside Train Yards right now is interesting because there's a huge opportunity to make it basically the new Midtown Manhattan because they're train yards, and usually train yards are covered up. And historically, in the case of Midtown East, right behind Grand Central Terminal, that also used to be train yards. And they were decked over in 1913 all the way to the 1920s to make what is now known as Midtown East. This recently happened in Hudson Yards. As I mentioned, the Long Island Railroad goes into the train yards of the Hudson Yards. That was also decked over. So far, half of it, and the other half will be decked over as well soon to make Hudson Yards, a massive $19 billion development. This might also be decked over at some point. But there's a few other secrets. And before we go see the other secrets, here's how the construction looked like to build the tunnels. This is a painting done. And the northern part of the tunnels, if you take the Amtrak, you'll notice if you go to Boston, you notice you cross into Queens and into the Hell Gate Bridge, which was also built by the same company. Now, as I mentioned, the man who ended up building all of this, the original old Penn Station, not unfortunately this lower devolved version of it, was Alexander Cassatt. And Alexander Cassatt was actually married, or not married, he was the brother of the famous painter Mary Cassatt. She was an impressionist painter based in Paris, and she actually painted her brother with this kid. And Maxson says that the Hellgate Bridge looks like the Sydney Bridge. Yes, that's because the Sydney Harbour Bridge was directly inspired by the Hellgate Bridge, which still stands here in New York City. Unfortunately, the Hellgate Bridge is nowhere near as famous as the Sydney Harbour Bridge. So Sydney, you took our thunder. Damn you, Sydney. Damn you, Australians. All right, let's Australians always taking the thunder. They took the thunder with Hollywood stars, with like Hugh Jackman. Took the thunder with indie films like Crocodile Dundee. Taking the thunder with coffee shops, making better coffee. And now they're taking the thunder also with bridges. Damn you, Australians. Now let's go to another secret over here. So, there's a bit of troublemakers here, so let's move away. So here is a very... This is the Hilton Passageway. And the Hilton Passageway has this, this used to connect to 34th Street, Herald Square. It used to connect all the way to 34th Street, Herald Square. But it was actually sealed a few decades ago, back in the late 70s, because there was too much crime happening in the passageway. It was a security risk.
Attention, please.
So unfortunately, this is what Penn Station used to look like more in the 1970s. All right, let's go over here, this way. And let's go back here. All right, now let's go through the new exit of Penn Station. Hey, New York Sea Tours, thank you so much for a $5 super chat. So these brass, again, all homage to old Penn Station. Or not homage, still remnants of old Penn Station. And I'll show you. Actually, before we go to this new entrance, there's one other thing here. Let's go over here. Hey, for people on Facebook, if you're getting spam, just report them. Sorry about that. It's a little bit out of my control sometimes. You know, spammers just pop up. I do my best to ban as many of them as possible, but just report those spammers, and they'll hopefully go away and ignore them. So here we have Ghost series, and this shows how much and of course Penn Station is connected to the subway, the 123 station, and on the other side is connected to the ACE, and the 123 station is as depressing as Penn Station itself.
As an alternative, the shuttle bus service is available.
So let's go up the new staircase, which I'm excited for. And they're finally letting a little bit more light. So finally we can see light here in current Penn Station. And this is their plans right over here to make. Do they allow eating inside the station? They do. Because of the pandemic, it's a bit more blurrier, but generally there are food places in the station. All right, let's go back upstairs. Oh, wow. This is marvelous. So glad they upgraded this. Beautiful, new, gorgeous. Depressing, ugly. New York City map, yes it is. And there we go. We are outside. Boom, we have the Empire State Building right in front of us. Looks like a train travel tunnel, says Miss. Yeah, Miss indeed. And they also put skylights here. Oh, this is smart. No, oh, not a skylight, just, oh, come on. They missed an opportunity here. These are just, not sure what they are. Blockades, maybe they will become skylights. Maybe they're just protected right now.
So if you want to go to Long Island, it's better using going
to. So here is the skyscraper that replaced old Penn Station, the offices, and Madison Square Garden as well. So, as that architectural critic said, once we entered like gods and now we scuttle in like rats, maybe this is a good sign that once we will be more like gods again here in New York City and no longer relegated to dark, damp, underground places, finally allowing light to come in through and brighten up our own city. So hopefully that is the case. Thank you everyone so much for watching this tour of Penn Station. I'll do a few more videos on it. Oh, you guys want some coffee? Can I give you a coffee recommendation? Let me know, let me see. What is a good coffee place here? Yeah, let me know if you guys want a coffee recommendation or you want a coffee break. Pizza, oh yeah, Pizza Suprema is good. stay tuned. I'll feature coffee some other time. Stay tuned. Because here we got to do a little bit more walking. But I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Actually, how many? We do have a lot of people tuning in. We have a lot of people tuning in. Okay. Let me know. Vote on it. Do you guys want a coffee break to end this tour? I could go for a coffee right now. Let me know. There's a little bit more walking involved, but since we already have so many people tuning in, not in Starbucks in Penn Station. Oh no, we're going outside Penn Station for this one. Let me know if you want a coffee break. But we do have to walk a little bit, so heads up. For a good coffee, we have to walk about 10 minutes. Okay, we're getting a lot of yeses. Whole lot of yeses up in here. JL says no breaks. I'm done with the walking, though, like the exploration history part is done. But if you're down for coffee, let me know now. Speak now or forever hold your peace. Bluestone Coffee is 31st Street. Yeah, it is. There is a Bluestone at Hudson Yards. There is a Bluestone. But I'll show you a different coffee shop. All right. Let's go. Coffee break. Everyone voted for, a lot of people voted for a coffee break. All right, let's do this. All right, now let's walk for a coffee break. This brings us to the end of our Penn Station tour. Hope you enjoyed the historical tour of Penn Station. Now let's enjoy some coffee. But not in Penn Station because, you know, I kind of had enough of Penn Station for one day. Is Bluestone good? I do like Bluestone. Yeah, I do like them. But the Bluestone Lane on 31st Street, has a whole lot of construction going on at the moment. So it's not very pleasant to go there yet. But it's a beautiful area. Hopefully once the construction stops, it'll be nicer to go there and sit outside. So here's Macy's. Someone says, I have good energy. People keep looking at you. Yeah, indeed. Indeed, I can't wait to drink some water very soon. Well, let's get away from these crowded streets. Go somewhere a little bit more peaceful. Mom and pop coffee stores are rare in this area. Rare. So we'll be going to a local chain. But fortunately, an individually owned mom and pop, there's not that many in this area. If anyone does know of any, do let me know, but I doubt there's any of them. So now that we're walking into the garment district, and there's beautiful buildings here. Absolutely love walking in this area. Is there mom and pop coffee trucks? Ah, that is also rare. I don't know of any coffee trucks. There's Peddler Coffee in Soho, which is a coffee cart, but there's very, very few. If one or if less than a handful. Alexander gives a $1.99 super chat. Thank you so much. Scaffolding everywhere. Oh yeah. But always look up here. Video. We're too far away from 129th Street. Way too far. But I appreciate the recommendation. Thank you so much. Cynthia with the $10 super chat. She says for a cafecito. Oh, gracias, Cynthia. We'll probably have that cafecito. So Cynthia's joining along with sponsoring a coffee. Reg, $10 super chat. You inspired me to live stream in Detroit. Ooh, I can't wait to see it. That's awesome. Cool. Felix Roasting Company. Yeah, I know video. Video, all those places are very far. We're at 36th Street. Pretty far away, those places. Detroit sounds great for live streams. Yeah, I can imagine. There's a lot of history there. Looks like a hot area, says Luciano. So Luciano is referring to the place looks like a bit dangerous. There are shady characters here. I will be honest. This is 7th Avenue. If you go to 8th Avenue, a little bit shadier. Yes. A little bit more homeless. Yes, in Garment District. But it is not dangerous from my perspective. I never feel unsafe here. In Penn Station, we encounter a few rabble-rousers talking about the camera, but if you just generally ignore them, they won't try anything. So, yeah, I feel fairly safe in Carmen District, even though it might look a little bit shady. Usually, the shady characters are relatively harmless. Shady, if people don't know, shady means like suspicious. What's another good word for shady? Suspicious is a good word. Let me know if you know any other words for shady. We're only a few blocks away from my coffee recommend of the Garment District. Dodgy. Thank you, Phil. Dodgy is what a lot of UK and Australians might know. Dodgy is a good word. Thank you. Scandalous? Not quite, but dodgy is a good word. I like dodgy. Nasimi, I'm not looking for trouble necessarily. That's what I want to make a little bit of a difference. Kathleen says, you have a good energy, so you're fine. I'll always send your Reiki positive energy. Oh, thank you so much, Kathleen. I appreciate it. Nino, $1.99 super chat. Thank you so much, Nino. Sketchy is another one. Thank you, Sally. Ooh, I love that people know all these words. Awesome. Unsalubrious. Ooh, that's a very good one, Mike. Unsalubrious. Oh, I like that one. So here we have Ben's, which used to be, or maybe still is, one of the old school sandwich shops, kosher cuisine here in New York City. This is where Lin-Manuel Miranda often got his lunch during Hamilton, while performing Hamilton. He said that he was a fan of the turkey sandwich and also the matzo ball soup. Daryl, that's quite not the best word to use, I think. That word is a very heavy, loaded word. Phil says you're a powerhouse for style. Oh, thank you. Supercalifragilistic expialidocious, says Elise. I think that'd be something else, but it's a beautiful word nonetheless. So here we have the famous needle and thread on Fashion Avenue, the garment worker right down there. Let me zoom in. And here at 39th Street and 7th Avenue, walk down here. Hopefully they are open. Oh, I so hope they're open. I'd be so disappointed if they're not. Are they open, everyone? Crossing fingers. Yes, are they open? No, they are not open. What are you doing? Damn you, Australians. Cafe Grumpy is closed, ladies and gentlemen. Are they closed on the weekends? Back in a few weeks, whoa. Hey, Mr. Vera, oh, thank you so much, Ariel, for the stars. I appreciate you. Ah, Cafe Grumpy is closed. That's a big shame. Okay. Well, I'll take you to the second alternative. It's a little bit of a walk, but I think I have a feeling you guys like walking or watching walking. So let's go to the other one nearby. Which is not quite a local chain, but is a regional chain, at least. Let's go over here. Jackie says, so is this a blame every aggregation on Australia Day? It's all in good fun. I'm just joking around. I love Australians. To all the Australian people out there in the world, my heart goes out to you. Thank you so much. In reality, I'm actually jealous of Australians. You know, people like Hugh Jackman, just wonderful, wonderful people. Who else? Let me know, famous Australians. I'm jealous of these Australians. Gregory's is closed as well. Wow. Said January, things start closing down. Chris Hemsworth. Yes, Chris Hemsworth and his brother, Liam Hemsworth. Great pick. Famous Australians. Heath Ledger, another famous Australian, actually started a coffee shop in the brunch place here in New York City. Two Hands and Five Leaves. A great Australian. May he rest in peace. Guy Pearce. Oh, yes, another great Australian. Olivia Newton-John is Australian? Keith Urban? He's Australian, really? Oh, wow. He makes a great American accent. Mel Gibson as well. Michelle's Aussie. Oh, welcome. Isla Fisher is also Australian. Nicole Kidman. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. She's definitely Australian. Most definitely Australian. Nicole Kidman, super Australian. Carl Urban is New Zealand, so close enough. Michael, oh, not quite. That would be considered now a national chain, Blue Bottle. Blue Bottle would be a national chain because they're now owned by a major company, Nestle, and they're all around the US. We're going to a regional chain, which is in this area of the US. Paul Hogan, Margot Robbie as well. Yeah, a lot of people. Oh, I'm glad. Joanne, we're heading towards a coffee to end this tour. People are very curious about coffee. I'm not sure why, I barely drink it. I'm joking, I drink a lot of it. So I think that's why people are keen on coffee. All right, everyone, cross your fingers, cross your collective fingers. More fingers crossed, the more chance it is open. And here we have the regional chain, La Colombe. I toured it, met the CEO, wonderful guy. Let's go inside, grab a coffee. Hi, how's it going?
Good, how
are you? I'll have a cold brew, please.
Sure.
And let me see what pastries you have. What is this cookie in the back? Oh. I'll have the croissant then.
The croissant?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. And for the cold brew, would you like any milk or sugar?
Black.
Black, okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, please. Thank you. Have a great day. Yeah, it is a very nice coffee shop. So this is La Colombe at the corner of 40th Street and 6th Avenue, right by Bryant Park. Right by Bryant Park. So great, great shop. Highly recommend it. Now let's go to Bryant Park, because there's no seating here. Where's the Daily Planet? Daily Planet is a bit further down on 42nd Street. This is 42nd Street. It's called the News Building, and it's a bit further down. Aren't you near that famous chocolate place? I am indeed. That is Angelina's, right down there. Yeah, I featured it once before.
Oh, yeah.
Here's a great Danish baker called Ole and Steen. Really like these guys as well. So another good coffee option. But I like La Colombe because, you know, it's local. So, I mean, regional because they're from Philadelphia. Here's Bryant Park, ladies and gentlemen. All right, here we go. Ooh, crazy dirty. So Bryant Park has a lot of tables which is nice. And the winter market is open for a few more weeks, I think, or at least until January 6th, somewhere around there. First week of January, Winter Village is open. And also there is ice skating open, usually I think until March. But of course, who knows what's gonna happen soon. We've been here before with you, says Don. Yeah, I've been here many times. So this is Nikola Tesla Corner. This is where Nikola Tesla fell in love with an albino pigeon. And if you wanna learn more about that, watch my Nikola Tesla's New York video. If you wanna learn more about the history of Nikola Tesla. So I ended up getting a cold brew. I needed something a little bit more light. Been having very heavy foods recently, so wanted something a little bit more lighter in terms of coffee. Not light in caffeine, because cold brew has way more caffeine, but it's a bit lighter in terms of acidity. So here's a cold brew. So cold brew is very kind of straightforward. It's a bit more chocolatey. It tastes like a very light chocolate, a little bit more like light chocolate. It tastes like almost like nutty and chocolatey. That's more of the notes that you have with the cold brew, at least this one, at least from La Colombe. And I also have a video, two videos of La Colombe on YouTube and Facebook. So it's cold brew. Cold brew is steeped in lukewarm or cold water. Oh, sorry, not right now. I'm watching that video next. And David Richards has a question. Oh, cool. I'm not sure how I can see it, but feel free to repeat the question. Where's the nearest Target? I don't know. Don't really go Target. And Don says, we've been here before with you. No snow. Yes, no snow. It's nice. Global warming winters makes it more pleasant. It's about 51 degrees Fahrenheit right now. And let's try before I bid all of you adieu. Well, sorry, not right now. Here is an almond croissant. There's a lot of people tried to... I understand people are on the hustle, but sometimes when you go to these parks, there's so many people trying to get your attention. it's like, guys, come on, just let a man eat in peace and talk to his camera. here is almond croissant. And I've been loving the almond croissants of La Comalome for years. My introduction to good quality coffee. My introduction to coffee, period, was Starbucks back in my early 20s. But then when I was like 23, 24, I started getting into La Colombe. And La Colombe at that time was known for their great croissants. Because beyond making good coffee, they're actually really good at making pastries. And this is what made me fall in love with La Colombe, was getting the almond croissant with either their cold brew or their latte. It's a bit drier, yeah. It's a bit drier than today. So maybe their quality isn't so high at this very moment in time, but still really, really good croissants. Nice, layered, and fluffy in the middle. And of course, it has a little bit of powdered sugar, and you have toasted almonds on top. I'm usually allergic to almonds, but when it's toasted, I have no effect, which is nice. Very crunchy, very nice. Someone said it might have been left in the oven too long. I think that is the case. So it's definitely not like Dominique Ancel level type of croissant. I would assume you'll probably be able to also find a very great croissant in, of course, in Paris. But if you go to these other Parisian bakeries, like Biencotte is another one, you'll probably find like really high level croissants. This one's kind of, it's on the higher end of the typical coffee shop croissants that you'll get. So most coffee shops have a croissant, but most of them, you know, mediocre. This one's a little bit higher end of those croissants. So I highly recommend the coffee and the croissants here. I'll stick around for 5 more minutes. Let me know if you have any last remaining questions about this area as I drink a little bit more coffee. 5 minutes, let's round up to 1 hour and 45 minutes. Mm. David Richards, let me know. David Richards left the super chat. Sorry, I missed that super chat, David Richards. Let me know, what was your question, David Richards? And Cito says no questions right now. All right, that's okay. I'll be here until 1:45. I can just stare until 1:45. 1 hour and 45 minutes for this video. So let's stare. Who blinks first? Do I use an iPhone? I do. iPhone 11 Pro Max. The guy behind you, when he saw your camera, he took off. Yeah, a lot of people usually do. Yeah. So it's a bit weird. I'm not entirely sure. I'm so curious, actually. Why do some people in New York, there's very few cities. This happened to me, it happens in New York, and happened to me also in Madrid. Why are some people so scared of the camera? It's so weird. It's like a tiny little phone. It's not even a big camera. And some people get really freaked out. It happened to, like, right now in Penn Station. You might not have heard it too clearly, but someone was really pissed off that I was walking around with the camera. I don't get that. That is so weird. Don't forget to make the 360 video. Yeah, you'll see that soon. I'll go back in a weekday where it's a little bit emptier. Thank you for the walk. How long will you be there for, says Veronica. I'm only being here until 4 more minutes. Some people are camera shy. Maybe that's the case. The question was about your photos. Do you sell digital? Digital. Let me know. Who wants digital prints? A lot of people have been loving the prints that are printed of my photos, but some people have been asking for a digital format. I can provide it to you. So let me know if people are into it, and I'll add it to Teespring on my store. So if you're interested in merchandise, I'll put the link over here. Where's my link? The Teespring, right here. Teespring.com/stores/urbanist. And there you can find my merchandise, masks, clothes, prints. But if you want me to add digital prints to it as well, let me know. But if you want to buy a print that's already printed for you or framed, you can do so at a different site. Unfortunately, I can't use the same site for prints because another site does it way better. Urbanist.darkroom.tech. And you can buy your official Urbanist photography there. How do I insert content? I like pictures and videos. So Carl, you're asking me to spill all my secrets. I use Prism Live Studio, an app that enables me to add digital images and videos and music and a bunch of other features. The Grace Building is right next door. Yeah, it is. What is Dark Room? Dark Room is a place to buy prints, print photography, or any type of print. But for me, it's photos. He did miss a button on this shirt. I did. Uh-oh. I'm not sure how you know. What equipment do you use? All the information is in the comments below. So iPhone 11, DJI, Osmo Mobile 3. I don't use the 4 yet. Great channel, I'm gonna subscribe. Oh, amazing, thank you. All right, everyone, 2 more minutes. Carl, $4.99 super chat. Thank you so much for the $5 super chat. Carl, ask me anything about New York. Let me know. Lightning round about New York if you're curious. Are there secrets about Bryant Park? Here's Nikola Tesla Corner. This is where he fell in love with a pigeon who was albino. He said that he fell in love with this pigeon more than the man loves a woman. Over here, as we're sitting, there's over 2 million plus books This is the actually majority of New York Public Library is right underneath us. And there's a few other secrets. You can watch my other videos about the secrets of Bryant Park. What's happening the rest of the day for you? Probably gonna film a little bit more. And you do a good job, Ariel. Thank you. My pleasure. And thank you. Take care, everyone. Eugene. Yes. Or where are we going tomorrow? I'm not sure. I don't plan too ahead. Wednesdays and Saturdays at 1 p.m. is my scheduled videos. I love your jacket today. Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Thank you for the secrets, says Kathleen. My pleasure. This was a quick fact secrets. Linda says, thank you. 30 seconds left. What's the most iconic place in New York City? Empire State Building, by far. Grand Central Terminal as well. Do you have an occupation? This. Storyteller and filmmaker. You do an exceptional job, says Alex. Oh, I'm so glad. Do you ever allow viewers to walk with me? No. Strictly no viewers allowed to walk with me. I'm always happy to say hi for a few seconds, though. Audrey, stay beautiful. Yes, Joanne. Bye for now. Thank you so much. And everyone, thank you so much for watching. Is smelling rather fragrant. I think that's why they were running away from the camera. People behind me might be smoking a little bit. So everyone, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate you. Hope you enjoyed the history of Penn Station. And I'll see you Saturdays and Wednesdays at 1 p.m. Try a lot cologne. Everyone, keep being awesome and always keep on exploring. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a great day. Bye-bye.